want to look at the economy. What do you think of the economic situation now?
Well,
you say the government has lost control of the economy.
You know, absolutely. But we must know the climate in this world that we are in at the moment. Most countries are facing the same difficulties with the COVID and the virus issue, the lockdowns. So certainly, those donor countries are no longer willing to extend while their home countries are in difficult conditions. So I can understand that. But this is the reason why we usually call for homegrown solutions, as you well know. Certainly, Ghana have set, you know, so many resources that we can actually depend on, instead of relying on the so-called foreign direct investments and the foreign donors, hoping they will solve our problems for us. It's never happened. You don't expect anyone from elsewhere, from outside for that matter, to come and solve this country's problem for us. Ghana must solve its own problems. This is the issue at hand. Certainly we are capable. We are capable to do so if given the chance to do so. And we must now, it's a wake-up call, so to speak. Wake-up call. We must take the troubles in our own hands. Let's get our hands dirty and solve the problems that Ghana is facing. That's the only way we can move forward and get into the problems that Ghana is actually facing head on. This is what must be done. So as far as the economy, it's glaring that we all see that they are facing a lot of challenges. But this is a wake-up call, as I said. We must holistically move forward, develop our foreign reserves, we develop our industries to give hope and jobs to people who need it the most. This is what must be done. Tackle it head on. We can't allow Chinese or foreign countries, for example, we can't allow them to come and take our resources, lock, stock and barrel, wholeheartedly, and take it to them and put value in their own country. Yes, I believe in partnerships. I believe in alliances, foreign alliances, but we must also create wealth to our resources, add value to it. It's a symbiotic relationship, you understand? Bilateral relationship, if I may say so, in the diplomatic world. But yeah, they want something, we also want something from them. We must meet them head on at the conference table and absolutely ask them what they need, what do we need? Is it a barter issue? I have questions about that. No, we must put value to our resources. Certainly we do have enough to go around the world, absolutely. But we must be serious in negotiating deals that's beneficial to Ghana. That's what must be done.
But don't you think there could still be a way to manage this such that people will not feel the hardship we are facing now? You think until we depend on our own resources, we'll continue to face these challenges?
I believe the debt structure in this country needs to be investigated. The amount of money that we've taken to retire some of the debt structures or the debt burden of this country needs to be investigated. Where is the value for money, for example? If you recall, I call for industries owned by Ghanaians, so to speak. Ghanaians must own the industries. And so you might ask me, where do we find the money to build those factories? You and I know Ghanaian businessmen or individuals don't have the creditworthiness, they don't have the wherewithal to take loans from elsewhere. If you take loans for Ghana, for example, we talk about 30 plus interest rate. It's really insane. You understand? Where you have a foreign country coming in with less than 5% interest rate, how do we compete? You understand? How do we compete? So yes, if you remember, during the campaign, I made clear that the government must take the responsibility. The government must be the catalyst to source the loans at a low interest rate and build the factories. Employ the people immediately. Look, factories are not built for years. 2 years, actually, maximum. 18 months, a factory could be built. And I'm not talking about, you know, the wayside, little bit of, you know, mom and pop, something that they label it, one district, one factory issues. Massive industrialization. This one must be done. Yes, the government can source for these loans. You understand? At lower interest rates because certainly Ghana must have the sovereign guarantee, so to speak, to back those things up. So I call specifically for the factories to be, you know, sourced and built by the government, amortized, the loan amortized to the government or the entity to be payable, whatever the amortization schedule is, the payment plan, so to speak, right? So if it takes 10, 15 years, once the loans are retired, the government must turn the factory back to the owners, the factory employees, by forming a PPP format that we talk so much about, but nobody seems to understand what a PPP structure is. It's for the fact that government can form internally a public-private partnership with their employees who are still absolutely capable of running those factories. After all, once the factories are built, who is the head of these factories? Is it an Indian, one or two of them? Is it a Chinese, one or two of them? All the employees, the ancillary employees, are run by Ghanaians. So clearly Ghanaians are capable if given the chance. You understand? So this is what I call for. Once the PPP is done within the Ghanaian structure and then the loans are paid off, structure is saying that the government takes a share of the company. And I use an example, you know, hypothetically. 40% to the government, 40% to the employee ownership, and float 20% on the Ghana Stock Exchange to build wealth for those who so choose to invest. We must do it. It doesn't take 10 years, 15 years to do a structure of this nature. 18 months, the factory could be built. The next year, 2 years, amortize the loan for 10 years, so to speak. Certainly, there could be a clause in the loan that is, you know, no prepayment penalty structure. So if you do decide to pay off within 5 years, the whole factory belongs to Ghanaians, Ghanaian ownership. That's what I'm talking about. People are there needing jobs. What are they asking for? Just a daily living, a daily income, something to be able to take care of their household. This is what they are looking for, really. There's not much they are asking for. Just to pay their school fees, their light bill, or their water bill, so to speak. You don't come and say, we promise you free light bill and free water, and then turn around and say, sorry. That is deceitful. This is the issue that we need to address. We need to be honest. Honest with the Ghanaians. We must be honest. It's our responsibility. The leadership must come clean. Transparency is what is needed in this country. You understand?
Now, are you sure this is possible in Ghana, since government, even private business, who have complained about the poor Ghanaian attitude towards work, for which reason even people are hiring foreigners to manage their companies for them?
Yes, I understand. I understand what you talk about. But look, most Ghanaians, given the chance, go outside, they work. They work well. It's about value for their labor. You understand? Value for labor. Are you surprised that they are not doing well? Are you surprised that they're not being paid well, therefore corruption permeates the system? Because how do you pay somebody 100 cedis a month in this country to clean the streets? Are you sure the person is going to do that work diligently in this country? Hell no. Excuse my language. No, it's not going to happen. So we must be honest with them. Pay the people well. Value for their labor. You understand? And have incentives. So in case you are caught with corruption, you lose everything. That is the carrot and the stick structure. You see, give them carrot and make sure the stick actually works in case they fall. This is what must be done. We must be serious for a change in this country. Ghanaians are asking for help. Ghanaians are needing help. Ghanaians are desperate. We must listen to them. This is what must be done. We cannot any longer wait for people to come from elsewhere and tell us what to do. We are old enough. We've aged enough to be able to see what goes on elsewhere in this world. We must study them. We must modify them to suit our cultural practices here in this Ghana. And the homegrown structure must be the issue that I'm talking about.
One of our headaches now is that I'm sick. 2017, President Akufo-Addo made a strong commitment he was going to fight it, to the extent that he said he wouldn't mind even if he lost his second term bid. But he seemed to have lost his fight on the way.
You know, I do not want to criticize the MPP or His Excellency in the Nabo, because certainly they have their own plan of action. But I would have done it differently. Why are the people out there digging mud and getting buried? So many of them have been, you know, are dying in the mines or the so-called ditches that are falling on them, right? We know it. So yes, they are mining structures now in this world that are non-polluted, for example. but rules must prevail. There must be a buffer zone from the borders of the or the lake lines or the river beds or around the rivers. There must be something that is a no-go area. Why are these people mining? So if we created the jobs that they need, maybe it will reduce. Yes, we must look at them seriously, but I will go further. Ghanaians must be given the opportunity, the privileges to mine. After all, it's wealth that we're looking for, but they must be structured in such a way that they must be licensed. If you foul against the law, you lose your license, and there's punishment that goes along with it. Yes, I believe we have the precious minerals commission in this country that is supposed to charge to purchase those mines. What happened to that department? What happened? That means the law is not working. You have somebody, a foreigner, who comes in to purchase gold in Ghana, yet the government doesn't know who is selling it, who is being taxed. I believe there's no tax issues that have been done. We're losing money. We're losing tax that can fuel this economy. You understand? So what if Ghana, the government, say, look, we are going to be the sole purchaser of all these Galaxy boys. Yes, if you have a small something of gold, you can certainly go to the precious minerals office and the government will purchase it immediately from you. That's immediate wealth to these people to support their lifestyle. Therefore, the government now becomes the sole exporter or the sole sell to the foreign countries. So if you, listen, we welcome them. Come and buy the gold, but you must go to the office, the structure that the government has put in place so that we can tax them properly. This another structure. We must put some structures in place that will work. Yes, there may be some challenges, but as we go forward, we can fine tune those structures to make sure we take control of our assets in this country.
Now the government is fighting back, and they are now seizing and burning excavated and all.
Is that the solution? Burning, guns blazing, own citizens who are hungry. You're turning the guns on them. Are we at war with our own citizens? No. It shouldn't be the immediate solution to this thing. Why don't you sit down with them? Form cooperatives, mining artisanal cooperatives. You understand? So that we know that the rules are being abided by the cooperative, the leadership of the cooperatives, or the union, so to speak. But they must comply that whatever you get, I don't care how much, is it a kilo of gold from somewhere, the next day you can walk to the office of the government that are charged to purchase from you, and immediate cash will be given to you. I believe that would be the best solution for all of them to be happy, to be able to support their families. So yes, the structure must be looked at, seized, but prosecute the owners. Prosecute the owners. That's what must be done. If for no other reason, yes, we can donate it to the assemblies to take care of their village roads, the so-called roads, the foodstuff stuck in the hinterlands could be brought to markets to support the farmers and the cocoa farmers who need it. No, it must not be so, but we can look at it seriously.
Yeah. Now we have the citizenry, especially the youth, calling on the government to fix the country. And someone who has been talking about the citizen demanding accountability from government, you must be excited about.
I am seriously excited. People's movement, we must demand change. Absolutely, it's necessary. People only get to the streets to demand when they are frustrated. But this is not working. The system is not working, and we all know it. Okay, the propaganda is enough in this country. The sugarcoating of issues must stop. We must be honest with ourselves. We must be honest with the people of this country. Tell them the problems, and hopefully they may actually share some ideas on how to solve it. You understand? I believe if you go to the hinterland, they know the problems that they're facing. They will tell you. Engage them. It's not about sitting in parliament. It's not about sitting at the Jubilee House and spewing some programs that you think is going to work. Get down to the streets, get down to the villages, ask them their needs. Maybe they might have more intelligence than you might think. Yes.
All right. Thank you very much for your time. We are grateful.
Thank you.